relished in dirty backgrounds, layered textures, tone edges, hand-drawn doodles, distressed fonts, real-life imagery and cutouts, grunge design pretty much breaks the rules of good design. Forget white spaces and pixel-perfect elements. Ripped edges, uneven lines, crooked elements are the cool thing. Hello and welcome to Breakdowns, where we talk design. And in today's episode, we talk about grunge and some really cool effects, like say dispersion, that you can very easily create and use on Photoshop. Effects that will make your posters look super trip out, from this to something like this, in just 5-7 minutes. So before we even start off on Photoshop to achieve that look, let's talk a little bit about grunge itself. Grunge isn't just a design style. It's an experience of a world with imperfection and raw emotion, if I want to use some drama. And honest to God, I feel that way about it. Folks who know me and who have worked with me for a very long time, who've kind of seen the stuff I've made in the past, know how much I love this design aesthetic and vibe in general. Characterized by colors bleeding into each other and intentionally highlighting mistakes, it uses heavy textures that evoke a sense of dirt, mire, grime, and adding layers of depth to the visual narrative. Now, this may seem like a cheap-ass way to kind of show some of my posters, but like I said before, folks who know me know how much of a fan I am of this style in general. To achieve this unique aesthetic of grunge, designers use a lot of different techniques in their repertoire. Spray-like effects, scratched-out fonts, dispersion, and various splashes of paint contribute to the overall rugged experience. These elements not only break away from conventional norms, but also infuse a sense of rebellion and authenticity into the artwork. This kind of design style also makes sure that there's a story to tell within the poster, and using these elements and this different complex layering structure, you're able to communicate that in a single image or visual. Mind you, the originality of grunge though isn't everyone's cup of tea. Some will loathe it and some will really appreciate it for standing out and breaking all rules and conventions. Like I mentioned before, there are a lot of different effects that can be used to get this entire grunge theme going on in your design. But the one that I'll be focusing on a little bit more is the dispersion effect, something which I've used in many of my posters in the past, like I mentioned. So here's a real quick example of, say, one space where I've used it for Black Swan, where you can see at the edges a little bit of the disintegration. Here, of course, the texture that I've gone ahead with to try and use is more from a feather perspective, because, of course, if you've seen the movie, you know what I'm talking about, plus Black Swan. But yeah, that's one example. Another is, say, Taxi Driver, a little bit of that checkered taxi kind of vibe going on. But again, Travis Bickle as a character just breaking through the course of the movie and just, you know, either getting washed away and being part of the city itself, or, you know, his character completely going through an arc. So in some sense, what I'm getting to is basically that layering, which kind of helps you tell the story through just an image. And that's where we should be leveraging grunge as much as possible, especially, say, the dispersion effect, when you want to show a character arc or a breakaway or a change or something, just getting lost in the environment. So before we get into Photoshop, let's deep dive into that thought a little bit more of where exactly grunge as a style works best and where you should try and use it more. So when do we use grunge? One, when we want to break away from conventional norms. One of the hallmark features of grunge design is its defiance against the conventional, right? In a world saturated with sleek, minimalist aesthetics, grunge boldly stands out. It invites viewers to embrace the unconventional and celebrate the beauty that arises from imperfections. By deliberately introducing messiness and grit, grunge design captures attention and engages viewer on a different level altogether. I mean, a whole f***ing music genre is called grunge. It's probably another sleazy way of just making a call out and showing some footage of my favorite band, Pearl Jam. But yeah, like with any design style, the time and place has to be right for it to actually captivate the audience. And one of the pitfalls that often exists with grunge is that through the course of time, it becomes a bit of an eyesore. So make sure you know where exactly the style fits and what kind of emotion you wanted to evoke from the audience and the viewer, and use it accordingly. The second is for that emotional impact, which I just very lightly touched upon earlier. Grunge design goes beyond just being a mere visual tool. It's a powerful style to convey emotions. The messiness and the raw textures, they kind of evoke a sense of depth and authenticity, allowing the viewer to connect with the artwork on a more profound emotional level. Whether it's the bleed of colors or the fragmented use of different elements or a mistake that you want to highlight, probably because, you know, say the character or the main point of focus in that particular design is flawed too. Each element has a very visual narrative purpose. And that's kind of how we should be leveraging this design in general. Alright, so now that we got that out of the way, let's really quickly dive into the Photoshop tutorial. If you like that real quick analysis on grunge and got a piece or two on where to use it, then don't forget to like, share and subscribe. So like I said at the very beginning, we'll take this image and make something like this. So the reason why I thought Oppenheimer would be a good example is because, of course, it's about a nuclear bomb. The entire disintegration angle fits in really well. And if you've seen the movie, you know how Oppenheimer's character itself has these shades of, say, objectivity and subjectivity. And of course, this is not an analysis on Oppenheimer. And there's a video coming up very shortly where I kind of break it down on Premiere Pro. We do a lot of that kind of stuff in Frame by Frame. You can check out this breakdown on Memento because we are massive Nolan fans. But yeah, moving away from Oppenheimer itself, the reason why I picked that is because of what I just mentioned. Okay, so let's get cracking on Photoshop. So really quickly, what we'll do first is just get the main character out from the background. So a little bit of a quick selection. Now we select and mask, and then just kind of feather it around, make it a little smooth so that the character is just a little clean when it's cut from the background. I believe there's some blemishes on the side, but not the end of the world at the very moment. And make sure that you take your output to a layer mask. So that's what we have right now. Now we duplicate it and just make sure we have just the character as a separate layer as well. So we're looking at having one where the character is cut from the background via a layer mask and one with the character separate already, right? Duplicate of that as well. And now you'll see what I'm up to. Basically, the second duplicate that we do, we quickly liquefy it and stretch it. See, it did not be perfect, right? You've seen what the disintegration actually is, so you know what we're going for over here. And on that, we add a layer mask. And we all know how layer masks work, right? If at all it's white, that means everything is visible, and if at all it's black, nothing's visible. So the idea, I'm sure you're understanding, is to figure out how we can play with both of these. So like you've seen what I've done here, there is just the character with a white layer mask, and then there's one with the liquefied version of the character with a black layer mask. Now on the first one, using a dispersion brush, I will really quickly hide, say, the edges. And the idea here is to get it how you want it, right? This is really quickly me running through it, where I've played around with different textures, different sizes, different opacities, different angles, and you just kind of try and smoothen it as you go through. And right now we're working on just one layer, the white layer mask, for example, and hiding the edges. And you'll see very quickly how the dispersion comes through when we play with the other layer. So here, as you can see, just trying out some different brushes, a watercolor brush, for example. So I'll also show you really quickly how you can import such brushes, by the way. You can go to, say, websites like BrushEasy and figure out for yourself which collection or which set you really like that you can bring into Photoshop. But once you do that, the idea is then to play around with those brushes to get that vibe, right? Now that you're done with the first layer, we're looking at the second layer, where here, using a white brush, we start revealing things on the black layer mask, right? So this is essentially the liquefied component that is very clearly visible, and you can see now slowly how things are coming to fruition. A little bit of a cleanup of the text using either spot healing or the band-aid tool, so I normally like to put a filter like a dry brush so that more of the blemishes are hidden. That's kind of what this is. Now I've duplicated the layer, gotten a black and white version of the same, and we'll just play with the color a little bit, right? So again, using a layer mask, we'll hide some parts of the black layer and we'll reveal some parts of the colored layer behind it. And that kind of gives you this slightly washed out vibe that we've achieved. Now let's quickly get into the background. Here are some references that I collected earlier. I kind of like this one. So yeah, let's remove Cillian Murphy from this one and just take advantage of the background. I could have used content awareness, but day and age of AI. Oh, there's a little boy there, but this I can work with. A little bit of a content awareness cleanup. See, it need not be perfect. It's going to be the background at the end of the day anyway, right? So, yep, that's what we've got. Stretch it out a little bit. Play with the levels a little bit just so that it stands out. Stretch it out a tad. Little bit of a cleanup. The Liquify took the Oppenheimer Z to another level, as you may have noticed earlier. So, just cleaning that up a little bit. And there's still a little bit of work to do, but I hope you can see where we're heading. Here's a good opportunity to leverage the existing or the original background actually. Maybe on one side we can have the blue that slowly transforms into the explosion oranges, right? So again, all play with layer masks over here. Little bit of a cleanup in Cillian Murphy's name. And yeah, I hope you can see how that entire contrast is standing out. Just getting that subjective, objective thing. The calmer, the more peaceful blues are contrasting with the entire explosion which disintegrates our primary character. Just playing around a little bit more with the dispersion effect in general, getting some yellows on, getting some more vivid oranges around, and just cleaning up and polishing the edges basically. Right, now that we're largely good with the composition, let's see how we can fix the color a little bit. Let's make the orange stand out, make it feel a lot more in your face. And let's tone down the blues a little bit basically. So yeah, something like this. Reduce the opacity. Maybe it's too bright, too vivid. Something like this looks like it's good. Let's get a little bit of maybe color on the character's face. You know, different blending mode, lowered opacity, just for it to kind of stand out, look a little bit crisp. And yeah, no poster is complete without the name or probably without a tiny quote from the movie, right? In a font very similar to what was used in the movie itself. Yeah, but of course it's got to be this particular quote, whether it was in the movie or whether it's the OG J. Robert Oppenheimer who says it. Yeah, something like that looks good. Just a little bit of black behind to make the text stand out a bit. And let's see how we can get a border for this entire thing, because by default it just makes everything a lot more eagle, right? Something like this. But it's too, how do I put it? But it's too refined, it's too polished as a border considering the entire disintegration that we are going for. So probably make some changes to it in the very end once the color stands out a little bit. Yeah, something like this. So yeah, finally, just make the color stand out a little bit, make it a little bit more vivid. In fact, in print, if at all that's what you want to do and sell posters, then you want that color to really stand out. So that kind of a scene, right? And finally, with all that done, this is kind of what the final output looks like. You know, a little bit more of the disintegration on the right side, the breaking of the border as we transition from the left to the right, a little bit more smoke around our man Siggy. And yeah, I guess I'm relatively happy with this final output for now. So there you have it. A quick breakdown on grunge posters and how you can go about making one really quickly on Photoshop using something like, say, the dispersion effect. Granted, I need to do a little bit more on this poster if I actually want to make it original and put it up on Amazon for people to buy. And I probably will work a little bit more on it. But this was largely to kind of run you through the style in general and how you could kind of make posters happen really quickly with this kind of treatment. I hope that helped you with your hustle. If it did, please don't forget to like, share and subscribe. That'll give us a bit of an idea that this kind of content is what you actually want to see. And if at all it is helpful, then this is how it reaches more people. Peace out. I'll see you in the next one.